Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this year's Greater Manchester Green Summit, and a big welcome to everybody who has joined us here today. Launched at last year's GM Green Summit was the five-year environment plan for Greater Manchester, which set out its ambition to be carbon neutral by 2038. It also addressed the urgent need that we all need to take within the next 5 years to help achieve this and to ensure the health and prosperity of the region. As part of the City Region's plan, it pledged to have zero emissions from cars and buses by 2035. To do this, we all need to reduce the amount of fossil fuel, amount we travel in fossil fuel vehicles by switching to zero emissions and cleaner alternatives. Our organisers, Midas, are delighted to present this webinar on future mobility, the first of four live webinars as part of the Green Summit. Midas will showcase what the city is doing right now to meet its carbon neutral ambition and to highlight how international investors are already accessing the city region's advanced materials and advanced manufacturing expertise to address the urgent need and bring their game-changing innovations to life. For this session, we have five amazing panel members who are all innovating in low carbon projects across Greater Manchester. Before we meet them though, I'm going to introduce myself. So my name is Nile Henry. I am the founder and CEO of the Blair Project. I'm an advisor to the Metro Mayor of Manchester, Andy Burnham, as part of the Greater Manchester Social Enterprise Advisory Group. I'm a youth board member of the Manchester Climate Change Agency. And I think the biggest one for today is I'm your host. So to tell you a bit about the Blair Project, we are a vocational and technical training provider that uses the excitement and exhilaration of electric motorsport to infuse and inspire disadvantaged young people to pursue rewarding careers in the digital, tech, and engineering sectors. Through our innovative STEM challenges like Proto EV, we get teams of young people to convert used petrol go-karts into fully electric e-karts that they get to test and race to see which is the fastest and the most energy efficient. Proto EV taps into the climate change activism of young people by getting them to work with technologies such as low carbon propulsion and battery technologies. And we're also about generating the workforce of the future for the green tech revolution. As well as the stuff that we do with Proto EV, we've recently been awarded £4 million from UK government for our Manchester Innovation Activities Hub, which will be an innovation and skills training centre that will rapidly upskill Manchester residents in Industry 4.0 technologies in areas such as clean growth, advanced materials and manufacturing, and health innovations, and progress those Manchester residents into very rewarding jobs within Manchester Science Park. So that's enough about me in a nutshell. If you have any questions, please make sure to submit in the question box as well. But I think it's high time I introduce some of our panel members for today. So we've got Sam Lee and Sarah Kumeta, who are from Transport for Greater Manchester, but they will both be doing their own individual presentations. We've got Julian Turner from Westfield Sportscars. We've got Abhishek Singh from Hero Cycle Designs, and we've got William from Lilium. So, but also guys, while our speakers are doing their presentations, again, please submit your questions in the top right-hand corner, and please remember to leave your name and where you're from and the organization you're from, because I'm gonna make sure I give you guys a shout out. And then after that, after the talks, we're gonna have a 10-minute Q&A session where I'm gonna choose some of your questions for our experts. And just so you know, guys, as well, we're gonna be having some polls because we want to make this session as interactive as possible. So yeah, the polls are gonna be in the right-hand corner, and we want you guys to get involved because we wanna hear from you. And just to let you know as well, if you want to download any of the presentations that our panelists will be covering, you can download as well. There'll be a download button again in the top right-hand corner for you to view the presentations. And just a quick disclaimer as well, just before we head in to hear from our speakers, is that apologies in advance if you happen to lose you at any point during this broadcast due to technical issues. We'll aim to get that sorted and be back online. So the first speaker we're gonna hear from today is Sam Lee, who's from Transport for Greater Manchester.
Hi, good morning, everybody. My name is Sam Lee. I'm the one of the senior innovation officers from Transport for Greater Manchester. It's actually a privilege and honor to be here to speak to you about some of the innovation activities that we're working on. Through my presentation, I'll quickly touch on the way we collaborate and work with partners, you know, both from SMEs to commercial partners to academic partners to tackle this climate emergency and start looking at transport, you know, beyond just being tram, buses, you know, and that wider behavioral change agenda as a whole. So just a bit of background in Greater Manchester. Some of you may be aware, you know, this, and many of you may have seen this picture of the Manchester Death Star before. And that's the kind of wider aspiration around building those connectivities to make sure people can access relevant services, you know, quickly providing employment opportunities and improve people's lifestyle over time, you know, through using sustainable transport as a whole. As you can see, it covers both from active travel modes to our rapid transit offerings, such as the iconic Metrolink tram system to our bus services in the future as well. And all of this kind of fits into this wider Greater Manchester Transport Strategy for 2040, you know, that we've published to try and achieve some of these key objectives to tackle the climate emergency with radical changes to the transport infrastructure as a whole and its capability, really implementing solutions to tackle the active travel problem to make people more sustainable and healthier over time using that mode as a means. And establishing Greater Manchester region as a region of innovators to trial and implement future city solutions to be the most innovative city region possible. So in Greater Manchester, the classic phrase is that we do things differently here. And I think just to highlight that, you know, in the innovation team, we don't necessarily just commit various projects with consultants. We actually get our hands dirty to trial and learn by piloting. And a lot of the work we do is work as the pathfinder to the organization to really understand what future technologies are coming and what the opportunities associated with it, the potential impact, and how we leverage that technology to incorporate into our existing mobility mix as a whole. So as I say, a lot of the work we do is piloting and learn by doing. And this image is an example of a partnership with University of Salford, where we're trialing these autonomous vehicles on the university campus. But at the same time, Salford universities are developing an education program to create the next generation of engineering professionals in this space. And with all our project, we focus on kind of three components, making sure whatever trial we work on is commercially sustainable. We work out how we can transform this innovation into a business as usual activity. And the fundamental core part is that behavior change on changing the way we work as TfGM and providing better services to the citizen of the region. So is innovation about technology? I think a lot of times there's this confusion that a lot of the innovation is purely around tech, but actually is around changing customers' behavior and really understand customers' needs, you know, as time goes by. So one of the projects we've been working on with an SMU called C-Sense is using these smart light technologies and tracker technology to really build a picture of how a person travels and how we can improve their quality of their journey and providing safety propositions further down the line. But the data we capture help us drive future decisions and policy making on how infrastructure is implemented around the city. As you can see, this data captures the gender, age, and how people move around the city. Can we start identifying areas and near misses where there's a high chance of people getting coddled, as an example? Or can we start linking this to kind of air quality impact to provide routes that minimize the exposure to the cyclists, providing a smoother and safer experience as a whole? And a lot of the project, we don't want to just work on creating these trials to better understand from a public sector's perspective. We want to help companies come to GM build new partnerships. So C-Sense, you know, over the project lifespan, have developed ongoing partnership with British Cycling to provide them these smart lights to their members and also the potential insight from the data for them, the members, to use. And we don't just stop there, you know, what's next? And you'll hear a little bit from one of my people I've been working with from Hero Cycle, Abhishek. Is now we're looking at opportunities on how we bring these two partners together to build the future of active travel. What does the future e-bike look like? What does the future you know, active travel, pedal electric bike look like, and how that links into our wider B network vision, you know, with all the infrastructure that, you know, the mayor's investing in the city as a whole. So that's kind of one side of it in terms of that customer and user centric approach. But how do we, what technologies can we start using to better understand and manage our city system? I think over the past year and 2 years, we've been working tirelessly to look at new ways of understanding movement within the city. And some of the technologies we've been utilizing is, you know, computer vision cameras in the Manchester region to understand pedestrian movement. Is this particular solution actually is particularly prominent right now with the COVID crisis and how we look at social distancing as a whole. But at the same time, understanding movement on the pavements could help us better design that space and change the land use accordingly. We started to use the same sort of technology to understand movement of vehicles on highways and junctions as a whole. And that's the beauty of the next step, that traditionally a lot of these systems are designed for cars. How do we incorporate and make sure the solutions incorporate multiple modes, both active cyclists to pedestrians, and linking that into that prioritization agenda to, you know, to really encourage the sustainable modes and to tackle those green climate emergency as a proposition. So this is a project we're working with a company called Vivacity on, where we're using this computer vision to start prioritizing at different traffic signal junctions to better create flows for cyclists rather than cars as a whole, you know, to really encourage that cycling experience as a whole. And all this built into new data sets and new understanding of how things need to be connected. You know, is there a component where these connected bikes can link into our traffic signal sensors to create green waves for cyclists and pedestrians in the future to come? And all of this links into wider data and understanding of this sort of technologies. And one of the projects you'll hear from Westfield a little bit later on is around autonomous vehicle at the airport and between Stockport and Manchester Airport. You know, really underlining the impact of data in terms of future decision making. Some of the other areas we're starting to focus on, you know, is around micro consolidation and e-cargo and freight. And it's a really interesting proposition because the COVID crisis, the only reason we have been able to survive in this lockdown environment is because of the logistics sector. But how do we make sure it's growing and providing a solution in the most economic and sustainable way? How do we change the way places work? You know, this is one of the projects my colleague Sarah will be talking a bit more around, is how do we transform a traditional interchange or park and ride site into more than just a park and ride site? What the opportunity with something like this as a mobility hub, you know, to really create and change the sense of place? And all of this is not necessarily collaboration of just technologies, but a collaboration of partners in the Greater Manchester region, both on the academic side, you know, European partners, funding agencies, to come together to create great solutions and implement in this Greater Manchester region, to turn Greater Manchester into the shopfront for SMEs and partners all over the world. So that's a quick presentation from myself. I now pass on to Abhishek for the next session, which he'll talk a little bit more about active travel.
Thank you, Sam. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining. I'm Abhishek. And as Sam said, we are very fortunate to be in Manchester and operate from this really creative environment and vibrant environment, and in a field that is loved by the city and the Greater Manchester region. So this is a little bit about myself. I'm a disillusioned car designer, so really happy again to be in Manchester. I worked in automotive field for almost last 18 years. And now, I design cycles, which is my field of choice, with Hero Cycles. And being in Manchester has been an eye opener. Fortunately, we chose this city, and I'm very, very proud about being here and forging some relationships, which you will see are leading into, cause for greater good, not just for Hero Cycles. Our agenda as a design group for Hero Cycles is to bring cycling to all through innovation and collaboration. As you know, cycling has not, or cycle as an object has not changed, or transportation medium is a very simple one. very difficult to innovate. But if you are in Manchester, and that is what we have discovered, it is not that tough. You can bring in innovation to different aspects of cycling, and that is what we're going to discuss. As we move on, just a minute, sorry, yeah. So this is how we do the innovation and work to bring new things to cycling. We do category innovation. We focus on product innovation, bringing in ideas for new products. We are here to grow knowledge. We represent our group, Hero Cycles, which is one of the largest manufacturers of bicycles. And when we come out of India, to we definitely want to grow our knowledge, which we can take back to India. And no better place than Manchester to be here and collaborate and grow knowledge. We want to grow strong brands. And I'll tell you how we are, what our view is about that and market relevance. When we go to category innovation, we are working on a balance between very minuscule evolutionary design to radical innovation. We want to innovate categories which will make cycling interesting and link up people to different kinds of cycling. That is what we want to introduce. At the same time, we are very, very proud about the team that we have formed here now. All of them Mancunians, dyed in wool. And they have come out with ideas which can grow cycling in all different ways. Here you see a stem that can be that is adjustable, almost like a car seat adjustment kind of a thing that makes it more comfortable to ride. Then we want to work on bicycles which are electric bicycles, but you don't feel intimidated by the technology. We want to keep the simplicity of cycling. In growing knowledge, of course, we want to learn about every aspect of cycles. You can read for yourself. We want to fan out in as many areas as possible, and for that we are working with universities and local bodies. In terms of what is there that we want to bring in new in future, we want to move away from a product-centric or a marketing-led approach to a more experiential approach for cycling also. How are we going to do that? It needs to be seen, and we are betting very heavily on collaborations to bring that. We know that it is not possible alone. There's a lot of talk about connected cycles and software-led approach for cycling. We want to go into more customer-centric view, a personalization approach using those technologies. So we want to keep people in center while we do these high-tech innovation in a simple machine, which is cycle. This one is an example Sam touched about briefly. I'll tell you a little bit more in detail. We are very, very fortunate to have discovered C-Sense through TfGM, and are working in partnership with TfGM along with C-Sense to get this vision of connected cycles realized. We believe that electric bikes are the future, but electric bikes alone won't be the future. We want electric bikes to talk to the city infrastructure and also to other vehicles around when they are moving around, so it is safe as well as you are connected. And that is what we have discovered that we can do through C-Sense technology, which sort of acts as a link between us and whatever good things that Sam was talking about in a wider city network. How are we keeping ourselves relevant to market? We are forming relationships not just with large bodies like TfGM. We are working with individual innovators. On the left, you see Lee, who wanted to work on something for his a neighbor, a small kid who has some learning disabilities. We are supporting projects like that. He wanted to bring the joy of cycling to Les and to Lou, and we want to support that. We are working very actively on it. Along with it, we are working with young students from Manchester Metropolitan University. We have formed a really great relationship there. Those students, of course, are source of lots of ideas. At the same time, it helps us sort of keep an eye on our talent that we want to be a part of our team. So that way, this relationship and our location in Manchester has been a blessing in disguise. Coming to the last part of my presentation, where are we going in future? Where do we want to take this partnership? We want to grow it to another dimension altogether. Hero as a group is opening a largest, one of the largest, I would say, manufacturing parks in India, which will have a technological center along with it. It is going to be a center which will address almost 10% of world's cycle manufacturing demand. But it is going to be a high quality research and technology led approach that we are going to take for the growth of this center. And talent is very, very important for it. And collaboration is very important for it. And that is where I would request all of you hearing and wanting to get in touch. We are open to more such relations that we have formed in our first 3 years in Manchester. And I look forward to more such interactions. So that's it from my side. Thank you very much. I'll now invite Westfield to present their exciting project to us.
Hi, yes, good afternoon. Good morning, sorry. My name's Julian Turner. I'm the Chief Executive of Westfield Technology Group. So Westfield Technology Group were fortunate enough to win the Autocar Global Innovation Award for 2018. Really exciting, especially when we've done lots of beautiful cars that you use at the weekend, and then we've moved very much into a similar area of technology, but use autonomous and driverless technology and software to move people around during the week as well. You can see from the work that we've done, there's a system that some of you may have been on yourselves at Heathrow Terminal 5. That's located at Terminal 5, taking people from the car park through direct to the terminal door, which has been a very interesting and exciting project for the Ultra Global PRT team. We've been involved with Heathrow to take that vehicle and actually put that into an open environment, as well as supplying parts and software support to the team at Heathrow. The most interesting thing about the system at Heathrow really are the statistics. It's taken over 3.5 million commercially paying passengers. It's actually successfully completed 6 million kilometres. It's actually reduced the journey time by 20 minutes. So it was originally done by bus, which took 26 minutes. This is now done. It's sort of 95% of people served in under a minute, as well as other fabulous statistics such as it being expanded over 4 times, which is really really exciting. But also the benefit it brings over cars, and as well as being 99% reliable, which is absolutely fabulous statistics. And if you don't believe it from me, then actually what you can do is see the stats here from the public, which has had nearly 20,000 views. And you can see just in itself, most of those are over 9, scored over 9. The value for money may not be, because you're actually incorporating the cost of going onto the pods with the actual car parking itself, which has been a success story. So just talking you through some of the projects that we've done. The first one, which was done in the UK, was actually connecting up Greenwich train station to the Thames Clipper and also the Ecology Park. Where 7 shuttles were built and 4 deployed at the Greenwich site, taking people around. It was the first commercial and trial of autonomous electric vehicles around the area, and it had fantastic feedback, as well as taking 5,000 people booked onto the service. The pods completed over 10,000 kilometres themselves very successfully. Zero incidents as well, which is fabulous for the first time this has actually been seen anywhere in the public. What I'm here to do today is really talk to you about the Synergy project. These are all the partners that are involved in the Innovate UK CCAV funded project, which aims very simply to take people from Stockport train station through to the airport, but also from the airport car parking through to the terminal. And the objectives of this project are all about reducing congestion, reducing the amount of bus journeys, reducing the NOx and SOx. That's not the SOx you put on your feet, that's actually nitrous oxide and other dangerous gases. Improving safety and also connect different modes of transport. Hence why we're trying to connect up to Stockport train station through to the airport. We're going to be trialling 3 pods and 3 cars, as well as looking at some of the platooning technology, which means that the vehicles are going to be operating extremely close to each other. So we completed lots of wind tunnel testing. We actually used parts of the A6 MAR that had been shut down during its build. We actually drove some of those manually. And the interesting work that we found from the wind tunnel and both the manual driving of the vehicles is that the car that's second in the platoon, if you had a platoon of 3, actually required 70% less energy for it to continue driving at 70 miles an hour. The third car only requiring 50% of its energy. So you can see there are enormous benefits to the use of platooning vehicles this close together. And what we want to do later this year and beginning of next year is actually to show 3 vehicles and 3 pods all platooning together, which is a challenge in itself, operating from Stockport through all the way through to Manchester Airport. One of the other projects that we have is actually working very closely with Manchester Airport and Emirates and Donata. Donata are owned already by Emirates, but they do all the ground handling and cargo transportation and ground support equipment. So what we wanted to do was to build a pure electric autonomous road sweeper, not that just went one and clean and went around and cleaned up at full power like a lot of the sweepers do today, but actually to detect an object such as a crisp packet or a cup or a bag, put the brushes on to that correct speed for that object and also suck it up into the vehicle. The idea behind this was actually it could operate at night time, both at the airport and also in future city areas, but also to have an operational volume level below 100 decibels. That's both with operating the brush, spray and vacuum. Obviously looking at reducing the NOx and emissions, and also increasing the efficiency of sweeping. So looking at having a camera on the front, not only to detect the object in front of it, but also to a camera at the back so that we can check that it has been picked up and detected, but also to create an agile platform for things such as disinfectant to enable hospitals, parks, areas to be cleaned, due to some of the latest COVID things that are going on. That trialed and still has been continuing to be trialed with Manchester Airport and Emirates, which is a great success. And you can see here some of the technology that's been deployed. So it's a dual mode vehicle that can operate on both pathway and road. It's got a fleet management system, so we know where the vehicle is at any one stage, what it's doing, what the state of charge is of the power. But also, very importantly, it's compliant with all sweeper regulations. And we've worked very closely with both the Civil Aviation Authority, the airport, Johnson Sweepers and ourselves to write the standard operating procedures for it to be used at the airport, because this is so such a disruptor in the industry. We're also trialling some of the 12-seater pod vehicle technology that we have. So that's going to be looking at moving more people around. Again, we're talking about trialling this with the airport next year. And this is actually based on the Ford Transit platform, which we've then converted to pure electric and then put our autonomous control system on it. And this doesn't mean to say that it can only be used at the airport. The idea behind this is it's extremely sustainable transport, very similar to the pod as is at Heathrow, but can actually take 12 people in a 6x6 configuration. So if you want to put the front bit doing goods or separate 2 families, then that's easy to do using this vehicle. The idea behind this is that we're taking our autonomous control system and now putting that onto a more highway orientated use case. We also have the cargo pod, which again is used on a very similar platform. And then we're going to be trialing this again at the airport, which is currently done by mainly a diesel truck or diesel lorry. This is going to be done using pure electric technology and advanced vision camera systems. But we are going to be also trialing some new battery technology called graphene supercapacitors, or carbon iron, as some of you may know it. and this will enable the vehicle to charge from flat to full in under 3 minutes. So in essence, as the cargo is being loaded onto the vehicle. It does have the option of chilling things as well. So if you wanted to use it for supermarket deliveries or movement of goods around some of the different areas, or to actually taking shopping to people's houses, we can guarantee the cold chain storage on the back of the vehicle as well. But this is also looking to be driverless as well as being pure electric. One of the projects that we've recently won, again, another Innovate UK project, is to look at disused and live railways to see where applicable and where safe to do so, whether we can actually run pods down this to move people and goods around. Obviously, using disused railways is a bit of a difficult one because some of them are conservation areas and also you have to rip up the track. However, if you look at the picture on the left, you can see this is a railway line, and you can see the land next to it is actually is unused. So we are currently working with Network Rail to convert some of this land for pods. It doesn't need a lot of work because the hardcore and actually gravel that's been used is already sufficient for the pod to operate on. So we're going to be looking at trialling that later this year and the beginning of next year to utilise and connect up people's houses through to some of the transport railway hubs. Obviously, some of the pods that we've got operating in some of the local areas, the Lake District National Park Authority, where we're actually operating two pods at Brockhole Visitor Centre, taking people from the house down to the water to the connect up to the boat, as well as actually just moving people around on some of the pathways, which is quite exciting. We've actually had them operating in Langdale Hotel and Spa, again, moving people from their accommodation through to the central restaurant, as well as moving goods throughout the day whilst lots of people are walking. Again, another successful trial that we undertook at the beginning of this year before shutdown. One of the things that we're really keen on is obviously the educational side. And I know that all the partners are heavily involved in this. But one of the things that we have done is actually enable schools, colleges and universities to build a little robot that becomes then autonomous, a very simple system using ultrasonic sensors to detect objects that are in front of it, then to move up to things like a radio control car that and then has its own autonomous control system. But also for very basic schools, we have a piece of A4 that can then actually be molded and cut out into a pod, so they can actually build these vehicles out of a piece of A4. So it gives you really interesting and gets great awareness for some of the young people that are interested in this technology. We do a lot of school engagement. And for those teachers that are very naughty, we do put them as a prop in front of the vehicle. Sometimes we're offered lots of money to turn the sensor system off, but obviously we're not allowed to do that. So the vehicle does come to an abrupt stop to make sure we don't do any damage to the teachers. The school kids love the technology, but interestingly, 95% of them actually don't believe that they will need a driving license in the future. So why are we teaching them about cars of today? This is exactly what this brings to the educational sector, is actually showing them how the technology works, but also asking them how they design the future transportation network. And then lastly, one of the other projects that we have been trialing in the Lake District is actually to look at the movement of defibrillators using drone technology. Because it's exactly the same control system that we use on the pods, we can put into the air. So we've been working with Harper Adams University to take a 20 kilogram payload around areas that we are allowed to operate under civil aviation rules. Again, it's using very interesting technology for battery life through to actually supporting the writing of the drone assessment test that's needed before it is able to fly. It's a really exciting project that we're looking sites to trial some of the goods, pharmaceutical deliveries, repeat prescriptions and things like that around the local areas. So that's it from me. I'm now going to hand you over to Will from Lillian.
Thanks a lot, Julian. Fantastic, and thanks a lot also to the Midas team and to Nile as well for the introduction here. Brief introduction on my side. I'm leading the global launch efforts for Lilium. Lilium is an integrated technology company which is building the world's first eVTOL electric vertical takeoff and landing aircraft, which is fully reliant on a jet technology, so an electric jet. I'm going to talk to you a little bit through what we believe will be the sort of transformation that we see to regional mobility. So actually moving a little bit from some of the intra-city options that we've heard Abhishek, Sam and Julian talk about today, to actually how we can connect Greater Manchester to the rest of the UK and also potentially beyond in a fully sustainable transportation solution. But Lilium is an integrated technology company. That means that as well as designing and building the hardware, building the aircraft itself, we'll also operate this in the future and are building the digital platform, which will enable this basically to be brought to all of you guys to become a consumer platform as well. There are really three core problems that we think we're setting out to solve. And the company was founded 5 years ago by four German engineers with these fully in mind. So regional transportation is highly polluting. You typically have three ways to do it today: road, rail, and aircraft. Two of those, road and aircraft, are of course incredibly polluting. And we all know, it's part of the theme of today, that roughly a third of global emissions, CO2 emissions, are being generated by the transportation industry, both in terms of the operation, as well as the manufacturing and infrastructure investments and construction that are required in order to connect our cities and towns today. Secondly, and of course critical to any new transportation system, we want to provide time back to our future customers. So as part of the reason of choosing an aerial solution here, flying through the air, you avoid not only traffic, but you're also able to traverse longer distances at a much faster speed than you typically would be able to with ground-based transportation. And of course, thirdly, we talked briefly about it in terms of emissions. Infrastructure investments for high-speed connection between cities are typically incredibly expensive, upwards of several billion pounds normally, and of course take many years to build. A typical high-speed rail line, and we all know of some of the ongoing projects in the UK, take upwards of 15, even 20 years sometimes to plan and construct, and cost well into the billions of pounds. With a Lilium service and a sort of regional, what we call regional air mobility service, you bypass that ground infrastructure, so it requires much less investment from a municipality point of view. Actually, you just need one pad, one landing location, as you see on the screen here, at each side of the route that you're trying to serve. You, of course, can do it much, much faster, as I mentioned, and because this is a fully electric solution that can take you to and from the city centre, you're able to do that at a fraction of the emissions as well. I mentioned that Lilium is trying to build a service as well as an aircraft here. So our aim is actually to build a regional network across the UK, across multiple other countries in Europe and around the world, that would connect cities, connect airports into city centres, connect city centre to city centre, in the same way that you would expect a train service to do. So really able to access that inner city, because the aircraft can take off and land vertically, as helicopters are able to do as well. The difference, of course, is that this is an aircraft which is far more suited to modern operations, both in terms of its sustainability credentials and the fully electric operations, but also the safety level and the low noise as well, both enabling it to access the inner city in a way that, frankly, helicopters and conventional aircraft can't do today. The core of the technology and what our team has been focused on for the last 5 years is, of course, the aircraft itself. It's a fully electric aircraft that can carry five people. So it's piloted, one pilot and four passengers, as well as the luggage that would be required for a journey like this, up to 200 miles at 200 miles an hour on a single charge. So similar actually to some of the innovations that Julian was talking about in battery technology, we'll be utilizing fast charging solutions so that actually by the time that you disembark from the aircraft, new passengers get on, you're fully charged, the aircraft will turn around in around 15 to 30 minutes and is then able to transit on for its next journey. And of course, this has the obvious applications that you see with rail today, connecting Manchester down to London in a time which would be less than an hour rather than the 2 hours that you see today with the train. Also able to do this in the same way that you can connect through the air today, but without having to transit out to the airport itself. I think additionally to that, what's more interesting is probably some of the regional connections that you're able to build here. So being able to connect across to Leeds, up to Newcastle, and to provide all of the small communities in the middle that frankly will never get even a high-speed road connection, let alone high-speed rail, a full 360-degree connection for a fraction of the cost that you would see in terms of connecting with ground-based infrastructure today. And when we think of what that can do for people in the way that you live, work, and play, we think of a concept called the radius of life. And if you all think, wherever you are right now, of the distance you can travel in 1 hour today through either the air, through a road, or through rail, typically you're not going to get anywhere with a plane in an hour because you need to get to the airport and you typically need to wait for at least an hour anyway. For a rail, if there are rail connections that are in high speed, you're able to go maybe in one or two directions back and forth, but it's a very single dimensional mode of transportation. And as mentioned, is often much, much slower than the high speed connection we'd all love. And of course, in roads, not to speak of the congestion, roads themselves are not nearly as fast as high speed rail and air are. If you think how far you can go then with Lilium, even if you had to transit to a vertical takeoff and landing vertiport, or the next evolution of a heliport, as you see here, typically this would be a less than 15 minute journey. You're then able to travel up to five times faster than you would be able to on conventional transportation today, which means that you increase that radius of life, that circle that you can go from where you are right now, by five times. And you're able to connect all of the space in between as well, which means that area of life that you have as well is 25 times bigger. You're able to massively increase the scope of what you can do within 1 hour from wherever it is that you live or work. And what we think that will do is to radically change how we interact, not only in terms of the rebalancing, the concentration of city centers to the periphery, but also in the way that we sort of interact with our social lives and the way that we sort of choose to live and work as well. I think that's especially pertinent in what we've seen in the last few months of this year as well, and actually a radical change in the way people are interacting with where they're based. Of course, critical to the success of this aircraft and our service here will be establishing the infrastructure that you see on screen. And I think this is what we would love to establish, not only across the UK, but further afield, is to build vertiports like this in city centres, in small communities. And we've focused over the last year or so on really designing a fully modular vertiport design here that we work with partners, be those public municipalities or private developers, to construct in different locations around the world. So that what you're able to do is to take an adaptation of what you see here, which is an eight parking stand and one takeoff and landing vertiport, and to turn that into something which can fit into your local region. If you think of the disused areas in industrial zones, if you think of the space on top of car parks, on top of railway stations, there's easily enough room to fit these into a number of locations across cities. And once you go out to some of the more peripheral communities that can be connected into the cities, then it of course becomes much easier as well. And of course, because you don't need that runway that you do with conventional takeoff and landing aircraft, you're able to access it with just such a smaller piece of infrastructure investment as well. I think we often, when we think about the problem of sustainability and CO2 and climate change, we often think that we need, and are told actually, that we need to limit our transportation habits, we need to limit how far we're going to travel, and we need to change our habits in that sense. Part of the vision behind Lilium, which is really to enable everyone to fly anywhere, anytime, is actually to make it possible for everybody to actually do more, but to do it in a sustainable way, to do it in a way that actually rebalances how we live and work, and to make it possible for all of us to fully engage with the city, as well as the region and the entire space around it, at high speed, but with low impact on the environment and on the world around us. Thanks a lot. Happy to take some questions at the end. Otherwise, I would hand over to Sarah.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sarah Kumeta. I'm a Senior Innovation Officer at TfGM. I just wanted to speak to you today about mobility hubs in Greater Manchester. Following on from my colleague's Sam's presentation, it's one of the recent innovation projects that we're currently working on. In particular, we want to ensure that shared mobility in Greater Manchester is accessible to everyone, and also create a blueprint blueprint to how mobility hubs might operate in Greater Manchester. Sorry, I've lost my slides. There we go. So for those that don't know what a mobility hub is, I just thought I'd introduce them to people that don't know what they are. But a mobility hub is essentially a major transport area that has varied interconnected transport modes. These can be the traditional forms such as bus and rail, but also newer shared mobility forms such as e-scooters and e-bikes. Most commonly as well, there's other integrated service offers as well. So coffee shops, post offices, stuff like that. So the concept of mobility hubs isn't new. They've in fact been around for a number of years. However, more and more cities are actively planning how their public transport systems will work better for their communities. We're trying to remove the reliance away from private car use, in particular to meet emissions and carbon change goals. So from a Greater Manchester perspective, I've just listed a number of the benefits that we think are associated with mobility hubs. In particular, we were keen to demystify some of the modes of shared mobility. We spoke to quite a few residents and there's concerns about electric vehicles, for example, and we think by making them more accessible in a hub format, then this could demystify some of the use around them. In a COVID context as well, we've had record levels of active travel and cycling levels. So we want to make sure that we also capitalize on that fact as well. There are inherent challenges as well with mobility hubs. We're not naive to the fact that there is obviously some things that we need to work through to make them work for Greater Manchester as a city. Being able to provide reliable and, reliable journey information to people is key. Having integrated a mass platform as well will enable us to do this. And I think as well, space is a key challenge for us. Obviously, being able to secure space for mobility hubs is something that we need to ensure is factored into all the town planning that we look at in the future. Building on this point, I just wanted to the carbon emissions are a key benefit of mobility hubs, but in terms of alignment with TfGM's wider strategic priorities, I just thought this slide was quite interesting. So as we know, Greater Manchester is set to grow rapidly in terms of population growth, and you can see there we look to have 3 million more people living in Greater Manchester by 2040. This equates to 600,000 more trips across the transport network in Greater Manchester. So it's really imperative that we do this in a sustainable way, that we manage this growth sustainably. In addition, an interesting point is this one around the new homes that we're going to have to build as part of this population growth. You can see there 227,000 additional homes. What we want to ensure is that the concept of mobility hubs are integrated into future planning, and that we work with key people across the city to make decisions to ensure that mobility hubs are future-proofed. So whether that's working with housing developments, office buildings, etc., to ensure that mobility hubs are part of the future blueprint. So that's a bit of a background in terms of mobility hubs. But what I wanted to share with you today is a recent project that TfGM are working on in order to test the theory of mobility hubs in Greater Manchester and get some key learnings from it as well. So TfGM, they are a project partner with Interreg Northwest Europe. The project is called eHubs and it aims to accelerate shared mobility services and in turn reduce carbon emissions. So we're one of six cities from across Northwest Europe that are working on the project with 17 project partners as well. You can see the stats on the side there, but we're aiming to introduce 92 eHubs across the cities. From a GM perspective, what does that mean for us? So we're looking to establish 10 discrete e-hubs, which will be formed of up to 10 electric vehicles and 25 e-cargo bikes. They're supplied to us by our project partner, Cargaroo. For those that are not familiar with cargo bikes, it's essentially an electric assisted bike with a cargo unit on the front that you can obviously transport cargo, but also children can fit in there as well. So how have we decided where we should place our e-hubs? We've worked with one of our project partners, the University of Delft, and what they did was create almost a heat map across GM of the demand for potential e-hubs. It's based on a number of factors such as population density, age, existing transport infrastructure, etc. On top of this, TfGM thought it was important to overlay some other lenses onto this as well. So we've also looked at factors such as number of existing charging units, the propensity of people to cycle in an area, as well as other factors such as antisocial behaviour. As well as this data lens, we've also recognised that the users of the hubs themselves are integral to the development, implementation, and also the success of the mobility hubs. So we've deep dived quite a lot into personas and worked with Cargaroo in particular to really understand what the use case is for these mobility hubs, as well as working with our partner cities that have that, you know, mobility hubs are already well established and cycling is something that is considered much more the norm compared to what it is in Greater Manchester currently. That's led us to three main locations across the city. So Bury, South Manchester, areas of South Manchester, and potentially Ancoats. We've got three, what we think, quite discrete test beds, because what we're keen to do is get, like I said previously, is to get key learnings to understand what is it that are the current barriers to, the current barriers to shared mobility, and therefore, like I said, we can create a blueprint going forward. So South Manchester, areas such as Chorlton, etc., are already got higher propensity to cycling. There's lots of little businesses, and we think that the uptake there will be quite popular. In comparison, Bury is quite a traditional town. There's not as many families there, but there's also quite a lot of business, so we think that that will be an interesting testbed. And then on the contrary to Bury is Ancoats, obviously city centre based, not the family network that we have seen in South Manchester and Bury, but we want to see how, if we can change commuting habits by having something in Ancoats. So I've spoke a lot about the physical infrastructure associated with mobility hubs in Greater Manchester. But we recognise at TfGM that it goes beyond just the transport elements. However, obviously they are at the heart of it. You know, as mentioned previously, the users are integral to its success. But mobility hubs need to be user friendly and integrated within mass solutions, so that users can access real time information and make efficient choices about the transport that they want to use, and also like seamlessly integrate between the transport modes available to them. In addition, we think that additional services could help mobility hubs go beyond just the transport that's offered there. So we've worked a lot with our partner cities to understand how they do that. Things such as parcel lockers, dark kitchens, pharmacies, coffee shops in close location to the mobility hubs have shown that people are more likely to use the transport options. So we're really keen to ensure that the space, basically making spaces work for people and therefore promoting the uptake, hopefully. I'm quite conscious of time, so I'll skip through these next slides, but I just wanted to show the art of the possible. These diagrams show like what you can really achieve when you integrate transport into other services. And I'm sure when we share the slides, people can look at these more closely. And then finally, just a couple of key questions that if anyone would like to help us answer from a TfGM perspective. This isn't quite a new concept for us, so learnings from other mobility providers, how do we encourage people to change their behaviours? From a long-term point of view, how do we ensure that the development of mobility hubs is future-proofed and we can ensure that they're integrated into future developments? And what's the best way to scale and adapt mobility hubs to changing environments? We want to, like I say, we want to ensure that mobility hubs are considered key parts of the infrastructure in terms of town planning going forward into the future. Thank you. That's everything for me. I think I'm handing back to Nile now.
Brilliant. Thank you, Sarah. Oops. Yeah, back on. Brilliant. Thank you, Sarah. And thank you to all of our speakers today. It's been really, really fascinating. And this is the purpose of why Midas are showcasing webinars like this over the next couple of days. It's really just to show everybody what is happening in our city right now and how we're going to meet the carbon neutral, how we're going to match the carbon neutral ambition for the city, and to highlight how international investors are already accessing the city region's advanced manufacturing and advanced materials expertise to address this urgent need and bring their game-changing innovations to life. So you've seen British organizations innovating and you've seen international companies innovating. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take it into the Q&A session. So the first question we've got is from Ian Barker, who has said, how much CO2 is generated by all the planes that fly out of Manchester Airport in a single year? And I'll direct that question towards Sam Lee.
Hi, yeah. I think that question is kind of multiple fold as a whole. I think with the aviation industry, the way it is, it's a unique opportunity now to look at what does that look like next and what does that look like in the future. As I mentioned in the chat, we are really keen on understanding what the future of flight means. As Will kind of touched on, yeah, there is opportunity there. But I think it's understanding what are the different kind of policy barriers and kind of infrastructure investment that we need to make some of the sustainable fuel solution happen. Based on my understanding, a lot of the kind of, as you say, the carbon emissions are from the planes themselves. And if we can start transitioning them into more sustainable fuel modes, whether or not it's electric, whether or not it's hydrogen in the future, you know, it's making sure the right levers are in place to encourage that behavior to happen from carriers. So there's a lot more other steps we need to go through before we get there, you know, from the regulatory perspective to get flights up and running. So right now it's very much trying to run trial projects to learn those requirements and what critical use cases there will be. And I think just one thing to add, you may be aware with the European partners that there will be a Green Deal program coming in the near future. And one of the key areas they're looking at in terms of innovation is smart ports and airports. So it's something that we're keen on understanding a bit more about.
Brilliant. Thanks, Sam. And the next question we've got is from Alison Preston. Do GMT still intend to collaborate with EU companies after Brexit, as certain EU countries already have good transport innovations in place? If I direct that question towards Sarah.
Sorry, can you repeat that question?
I think the question was around collaboration with European partners on innovation activities moving forward in a post-Brexit environment.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're very keen to continue to partner with other European partners. I mean, it's not clear how it might pan out in terms of how that happens post-Brexit, but it's definitely the intention that we continue to partner with European partners if we're able to. Sam, I don't know if you've got any.
Yeah, no, I'll just add a few bits. I think like at current, we're already established and engaged with a number of European networks. I just highlighted a few in the chats, but we do work very closely with the different European cities, and they do take a lot of learnings from the work we're doing here from an innovation perspective. I think we're just, as Greater Manchester, we're always very bad at kind of publicizing ourselves about the great work we do. Yeah, it's an ongoing partnership that we want to develop. But I think there's a wider opportunity, you know, as well to start engaging with SMEs from the European states and also internationally, you know, from countries like Canada and working in partnership in the, you know, other countries in the East like India to take transport innovation, implement them in Manchester and replicate in India or vice versa.
Brilliant. And the next question is from Goron, who says, what is the expected timeline for the introduction of self-driving vehicles to the Manchester streets? And directing that question towards you, Julian.
Julian jumping back on stage.
not a bit controversial. No, I've sort of answered it in there already, really. There are sites that are available to implement autonomous and driverless vehicles now. Obviously, it's got to be safe in order for that to happen. But that is the purpose of some of these trials that we're undertaking. But if you want to see, if the question is specifically about, will I see a driverless vehicle operating on the motorway with human drivers, I think we're probably between 5 and 10 years away from that. And that's mainly because of the other human drivers. If we have a situation where there are only vehicles operating that are autonomous, obviously we can control that area in a much better way. So you'll be able to deploy the technology sooner.
Yeah, I think just add a little bit from a TfGM perspective. I think we're running these pilot projects with Westfield to really understand what the policy implications and the infrastructure requirements for a lot of this kind of autonomous vehicle technologies. And I think it comes back to that fundamental point of understanding what the use cases is and whether or not that will change the way the city moves and how things are accessed within the city as a whole. I think I agree with Julian. It's quite a way away, but I think the unique opportunity in the short term, I suspect, will relate to kind of more freight innovation, you know, and for these solutions to be working, not necessarily during the day, but in the dark hours where, you know, we're resting and, you know, people are still moving logistics around to minimize its risks.
Brilliant. And the next question is going to go towards Will. Is urban air travel ever going to be a reality?
Absolutely. I mean, that's for sure our perspective on it. I think what we're seeing and the announcements we're making over the next couple of months actually will prove this out. So we announced just a couple of weeks ago partnership with the Northwest German regional government, actually for some of the first routes that we'll start building there, that actually they're building on our behalf that we'll start operating at. And this will be followed by a range of other announcements before the end of the year. So really the race is on and it's up to Transport for Greater Manchester and the UK to catch up.
Brilliant, and I'll do two more questions. So this question is, the ideas and aspirations of the cycling and walking programme are excellent, but with some of the temporary COVID cycle lanes already disappearing, is there the political will locally and nationally to enforce true change? And I'll go to Abhishek for that question, to answer that question.
A very good question. I think I want to ask this question and join in, you know. That should be a right one for Sam, actually, to answer it. Yeah. I mean, we are very committed, but we are a manufacturing company. We have very less influence on the city infrastructure. But that's where we are working with Sam and a group like TfGM, which keeps us informed about the priorities. And as far as I know, the priority is very high. Of course, cycling has come to the center stage after COVID crisis. And I'm sure all the slides that we saw and the plans that we saw of TfGM promoting the transport, images of cycles and cycling was pretty much central to everything. So I'm definitely keeping my fingers crossed, but I think the answer will come from Sarah and Sam. You know. So Sam,
I'll try and answer it without getting myself into trouble politically. I think like the central government, you know, that pot of money that helps with the temporary measures has kind of helped for us to understand how different intervention works, accelerate the implementation of some of the solutions and creating that safer environment. I think that the core thing we need to try and do more now on is capturing the data and the insight on the behavior. And as I presented, you know, that using sensors and different ways of capturing insight is critical to future investments and understanding kind of cyclist behaviors as well. So I think it's an ongoing process in terms of how we make some of these investment decisions quicker, but back it up with hardcore evidence. And in some ways, it's quite nice because with the CSANS project that I talked about, it's very much citizen-led data. You know, it's the citizen providing insights, you know, for political stakeholders and kind of civil servants to really implement these solutions with a data-driven approach, you know, on the ground and really understanding the problem.
And so the last question is from Freya Aiden, and I'll direct this question towards Julian and Will. Will these electric airplanes just transfer congestion from the land to the skies? How will they be monitored and controlled?
So, shall I go first, Julian? Very happy to. So actually, no. I mean, I think if you just from a pure physical perspective, think of the amount of space that a road takes versus what's in the air, you can easily spread out the traffic in multiple dimensions. So for sure, it shouldn't just increase congestion that way. I think that's point one. Secondly, we're of course talking about a shared solution here. And actually that's where I think it's a lot of alignment with what Julian was discussing, where you know you can pool and you should pool with multiple passengers. So you're not gonna be renting the entire aircraft unless you really have the desire to do that. It's not a charter operation here, but rather on a per seat basis. And again, what we're talking about is just connecting multiple hubs. So while you'll have very high speed, very high demand back and forth connections between two hubs, we're not talking about taking all of the traffic in a city center and lifting that up into the sky, but rather in the same way that you can bring people onto train lines or highway lines between two cities, we're talking about just condensing that type of traffic into aerial transportation.
Yeah, I'll just add to that. We've done quite a bit of work with a pharmacy, national pharmacy, and if you look at the journey that people make, for example, especially in rural areas, that you either have to have a bus, which doesn't make financial sense for the operator, or a lot of people just get in their cars to go and pick up a very light repeat prescription, and you have multiple people doing it, perhaps driving sort of 2 to 3 miles on a cold cycle on a diesel vehicle. It's got to be the worst thing for emissions. If we could do that, for example, with a drone or a similar type of machine that could then drop, you know, 4 or 5 different prescriptions off, actually you've removed 4 or 5 different journeys off. You've reduced the wear and tear on the cold start diesel vehicles, as well as reduced congestions on the road. So there are some really good, clean, easy examples of where we can make a massive difference, especially in the cargo and logistics sector. And then obviously, I think the same principle can also apply to the movement of people, as we've seen with the pods operating at Heathrow.
Great. And I'm afraid, guys, that's all we've got time for today. I just want to say a big thank you to our speakers and a big thank you to everybody who has joined us here today. If you'd like to find out any more information about how your business could turn your innovations into a reality in Manchester, please contact David Hilton from Midas. His information is on the screen at the minute. And if you'd like to find out any more information about the City Region's carbon neutral ambitions, you can register for another Midas webinar, and that's all on www.gmgreensummit2020.co.uk. My name is Niall Henry, I've been your host, and I hope you all have a great and amazing day. See you later.